All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sport Chat 503. Thank you guys very much for watching. First time, a long time. Either way, I appreciate it. Coming to you live from Portland, Oregon, trying to break it all down here on the West Coast. We've got a bunch to talk about. We had the Maryland game yesterday. It was very fun. Ducks are 10-0. Wow. And Dylan Gabriel sets a record. Bunch of stuff to chat about. Had a great time. Friends came in from out of state. They got to have a great experience. Duck fans across the board are rejoicing in their team this year. We got a bunch of stuff to talk about, and then we'll have a little preview of Wisconsin maybe later on. I don't know if I can fit the Wisconsin preview in this week or this video, but it'll be maybe later on this week. Shout out to all the veterans first and foremost. Appreciate your service. Thank you so much. Veterans Day on Monday. This is Sunday today, so appreciate your service, USA. And let's go ahead and get this thing started. We have a beautiful night in Autzen Stadium. The rain held off for the most part. It rained at the end a little bit there. But other than that, it was just a beautiful night. The uniforms were awesome. Shouts out to Maryland. The Maryland faithful came out. I don't know if they're all coming from Maryland. But, you know, the Maryland-Oregon thing, it's so far apart. You know, this was the game that felt like on the whole schedule that was more irrelevant than anything else to the fan base, is because this is the first time we've ever seen each other in any sort of football game. Not only that, but they're about as far apart as you can get. And, you know, Maryland field doesn't really feel like a traditional Big Ten team. And, you know, Oregon is definitely the new one on the block. So it is what it is. But this was a game that Oregon had to win. You look around the rest of the country and you see a bunch of other teams lose. These are games you need to win. And the fact that Oregon won it by 21 points, I think is fantastic. So wild stuff about this game. First and foremost, the uniforms. I thought the uniforms were fantastic. You know, Oregon went with a traditional look. I love this Generation O jersey. It looks great. It feels good for the players. It looks really good when you're up close. It looks good on TV. It just plays well. A lot of people with the jerseys in the crowd. I knew that was a thing from years past. They said a lot of people like to wear the jerseys as fans, and they said they couldn't access them or couldn't get them. This year it felt like Nike did a great job with the rollout. Everybody got the jerseys they wanted to get. A lot of people wearing them in the stands. Correlate with whatever game they're playing. I think it's fantastic. And then, you know, Maryland. This is an Under Armour school. That's the big dog for them. It's the flagship. And, you know, they did their best. Kind of hard to dress up an all-white uni, but they did what they did with it. They went with the iridescent numbers and the decal, the Terps decal. It was a really wild-looking decal. It almost looked like those puffy paint stickers you used to get in the 80s were all raised up, you know, all thick. But, you know, it was a cool moment. I know that Maryland is not the team right now that the fan base wants it to be. It's a pretty one-dimensional offense. They tried to come out and run the ball immediately right out of the gate, and they tried to establish the run as best they could. They just never really could. They did get some pretty good plays over the top with their passing game here and there, but Oregon's got a really good defense. That first drive felt like was very much assisted by the referees. It felt like the Ducks couldn't get out of their own way with penalties and everything else, but so many tip balls at the line of scrimmage. It felt like something was going to happen at some point. There was going to get an interception somewhere along the line. They did. I thought that was fantastic. You know, finally it broke for them. It had the wild play with the Jordan Birch strip sack, goes over. Brandon Johnson takes it back 60-something yards for the tutty. That was fantastic. But, you know, Tysheem's interception I thought was great, and then Justin Jacobs' interception was awesome as well. Both of those I feel like are very opportunistic plays, and that's the kind of thing for Oregon. Oregon needs to consistently get these opportunistic plays on defense because, you know, as you go deeper down the stretch, and especially into the playoffs, defense is going to win championships, especially this year. It feels like this is a year where the Ducks' offense is good enough to put itself in a position to be successful. It's just whether the defense can hold on their side long enough to make this thing work, like we saw in the Ohio State game, right? It does feel like Ohio State and Oregon are the two best teams right now. Clearly, they've identified themselves as such, and it would be phenomenal for the Ducks and the Buckeyes to see each other in the Big Ten Championship. I'm hoping that's the case. That would be a phenomenal, phenomenal thing to see. And again, we've talked about this in the past year. You know, the chances of something happening where you can see a team three times is astronomical, but it could happen. And the reason why it could happen is because it feels like there's less elite teams. It feels like those elite teams are coming from less conferences, and it feels like those conferences, you might have an opportunity to play them in the regular season as the championship game in that conference, and then out of 12 teams, the chance of playing each other, right? So the idea is where you're going to put them on the bracket or wherever else they find themselves, but this could be a crazy year, and wouldn't it be wild to see some sort of Rocky 1, Rocky 2, Rocky 3, like we talked about with Juk on Bucks, to be able to get this thing to a real champion and who's going to win this thing? Because obviously right now, the rest of the country would say, great, Oregon's undefeated and Oregon's beating teams, that's fine, but they're not the best team in the country. We don't know who the best team in the country is, and that's fine. That's why you've had the playoff, but you're going to really need to play some stout defense. This defense is playing great. Look at Jordan Birch. Jordan Birch comes back, you know, has a great game. As soon as he comes back, this one here, it was the player of the game. He was MVP. He was all over the place with the strip sack, with the fumble. Then he gets the punt return, or the punt fake. That punt fake was so awesome. And you knew it was coming. You could feel it coming. Anybody who's got kind of one of these, you know, sports sixth sense like I do, where you can just, you know, or you can feel kind of what's going to happen. You've seen enough ball. You know enough of the game to know pretty much kind of what you think is going to happen here. Just play the book, right? And I thought that was fantastic. You know, when that thing happened, when that thing went down, you put it in one of your best athletes' hands. I mean, who's better than that? And shouts out to Casey Rogers. Casey Rogers was in that same situation last year. Hike the ball. Go. Be an athlete. Get it. Tuck the ball. Hold it tight. But move those chains, man. Move the sticks. So I absolutely love that. Jordan's such a great guy. Looks like he could be a first-round draft pick. He's very, very, very disruptive. He's so incredibly talented with his quickness and his size and strength. It's just insane to have a guy who's that big, who's that fast. And, you know, the defensive end, he's just really good. You know, he's good at plugging the middle. He's good at coming around the edge. He's good at pushing guys right through the pocket. He's so strong. So it was really cool to see that happen. Now, let's talk about Dylan Gabriel. Dylan Gabriel sets the record. Case Keenum, he chased him down. It felt like it was going to happen. It felt like it was going to, you know, if you did the math on it, you know, and you had enough games and whatnot, it felt like maybe around the end of the year, this could be the case, but pretty special situation. I love how Dylan's just completely downplayed it, says it doesn't matter. You know, as a quarterback, any award you're getting for being throwing touchdowns or any of that sort of offensive success, all that's going to go back to the team anyway. You got to give love to the team. You get first and foremost the offensive line, the law firm. You got to put a lot of respect on a lot of people's names first before you really take any sort of credit yourself, right? Because everybody's going to give the quarterback credit. So I think that's a sweet power move right there. Dylan Gabriel's an absolute stud. His energy's awesome. You know, he'll want to talk with everybody. I see him after every one of these games, and I'm the type of guy who's like, I want to say what's up real quick, and I want to give my little time just to pump somebody up. It's not really about me or like my ego or something of like, I don't need video or pictures or anything. I do try to take some pictures sometimes. I definitely wanted to get one after that Ohio State game, dude. He put that big hat on. I was right next to him. When he put that big hat on, I was like, oh, this guy is feeling it. But he's one of these guys who's just a man of the people. He'll go out and talk to people for an hour if he could. You got to rein him back in a little bit. But he's having a great time. He's having fun. This is a great team. He's 10 years away from Marcus Mariota with the number 8. And, you know, the way that Marcus played, it was a game changer, man. We loved Marcus so much. We still do. Obviously, Marcus is like the guy. But the fact that Dylan's wearing number 8, 10 years later, doing some special stuff in a Heisman candidacy race right now with a freaking amazing player, Travis Hunter, right? It's generational talent. One of the best running backs we've seen in years, Ashton Jeanty. And, of course, I think Cam Ward's going to be there no matter if they, you know, how they played this last week or whatever. But Dylan Gabriel's playing like the best quarterback in the country. So you're playing like the best QB in the country. Usually they give it to the best player off the best team, and right now that's Oregon. So, again, this is a special year. You got to embrace this year. You got to try to do as much as you can, enjoy it as much as you can, have parties, watch parties, go to the games if you can, just be a part of it. Let's talk about this touchdown to Janoris. I freaking lost my mind a little bit. I love Janoris Wilson. Janoris came in sports chat and over the offseason. I always try to have guys in the offseason come in and tell their story a little bit. And usually the guys who I try to want to have to come in are guys who I feel like are going to be somewhat impact players in the next year. And I thought that Janoris was going to have a chance to be this guy this year. Maybe not in a rotation with the offensive line yet, but he's a super good athlete who's going to find his way somehow, some way. And this was amazing. So I got to see him after the game, absolutely pumped him up, pumped me up. And those are the kind of things, that's what builds community. That's what builds camaraderie, and that's what really we're here for. That's what the flock is here for to do. Josh Connerly in the same boat. Freaking love Josh Connerly and his dad, Josh Sr. How are you going to stop him running through a line? Again, short yarded situation. Why would you not just give it to your left tackle? Come on. I love that play. T. Ferg on the TD. It felt like this was the first touchdown of the year for the tight ends. I don't even know how that happens. But T. Ferg with the TD, it looked like they were going to take it away from him. Looked like his heel was on the line. Looked like they were going to take it away from him. But he played great. Noah played great. Jordan goes out. I saw Jordan after the game. He looked fine. But, you know, precautionary stuff. And you didn't need him. Noah did great. Jane Lamar did fine. But I really feel like Noah's finding his spot. He can dance a little bit sometimes. Maybe too much. And maybe not look to break it. But if it's not there, it's not there. The one thing I love about Noah Whittington is his eyes. My son takes photos on the field. Shout out to my son, Darby Winter Photo. If you want to get a good follow on Instagram or Twitter, Darby W Photo. He's got some great shots of Noah with his eyes about as big as you can get it, right? Just looking through the hole, like, where is it at? And I love that eye training for a running back. So, shouts out to them. You got to believe it's a win is a win. And, you know, it might be ugly. It might not be what you wanted to look like. But you know what? On the scoreboard, it looks like every other game out here. They completely dominated. Maryland never had a chance in this game. And it was a phenomenal night. Yes, there were drop balls early. Dylan puts a lot of spin on that ball. That ball is popping out of that thing. There were short yardage situations. A couple of them to T. Ferg, it felt like early. They cleaned that up quickly, and that was not a problem late. The penalties was a big problem. I didn't necessarily agree with some of those penalties, and again, I'm not a blame the refs guy, but early on, it felt like the refs were really, really one-sided, it felt like, and it felt like some of those penalties were just non-existent. But again, in the stadium, it's hard to see it. When you watch it on film, you can see it a little bit better, but in the stadium, there was a lot of booing of the refs. And then the turnovers, I thought, was the name of the game. You know, again, you felt like you were going to get these guys turned over, especially at the line of scrimmage. They were knocking down so many balls. And then that big strip sack from Jordan Birch. And, you know, how about just the athleticism of this team? I mean, this team is just so deep. And that's why I think it can be really competitive this year. So, Wisconsin next. You got your last big road game. It's the last road game of the season, but it's the last big one that people said this could be a problem, right? Everybody said Wisconsin late in the year, you better buckle up. I'm bummed we're not going to this game. I can't go to every game. it's not feasible to go to every game. I told that to Big Dave, my guy Big Dave. I said I'm not going to Wisconsin this week. He said, what? Why not? So I think it's a great environment. It's one of the best environments in the country. I know Wisconsin's not necessarily where they want to be. They're a team that's struggled. You know, Wisconsin's a team historically that is kind of like Oregon, from my perspective, in the sense that, you know, they play in a tougher conference. They're trying to fight for their respect when they do get it. You know, sometimes it's when the other teams are down, so they kind of take it. You know, that was for Oregon for years. For it was either Washington was down or USC was down. That's why Oregon was good early. Wisconsin never really gets, I feel like, the respect from Ohio State, Michigan, maybe, that they deserve. But Wisconsin this year, you know, is struggling. And the Iowa game was absolutely telling. They've had some time with that, which is fine. They need it, you know. Come out of the gate, Wisconsin. They win the games they should supposed to win. And they have this game against Alabama. Everybody knows that's going to be a phenomenal game. just to host Alabama. It's so rare. Alabama at that point was number four in the country. They get completely smoked by Alabama, and they look like they shouldn't really be on the same field. USC comes in, or they go down to USC, and USC embarrasses them as well. USC had controlled that game completely. And USC, we know, is not that good of a team. Maybe they were playing better that part of the year. They were 13th in the country at that point. They'd beat LSU in week one. Everybody gets a get-right game against Purdue. Absolutely hammer Purdue. Now we're like, okay, well, this is the Wisconsin team we're looking for. Now they start scoring points. They get back-to-back weeks where they absolutely crush Purdue and Rutgers. Then they beat Northwestern. They didn't score a ton of points against Northwestern, but they held Northwestern only 3 points, which is phenomenal. And then they lose to Penn State. They lose to Iowa. Now they play Oregon. Then they get Nebraska and Minnesota. They're a team right now sitting at 5-4. You know, can they? Will they put themselves in a situation? They're 3-3 in conference. Will they put themselves in a situation where they could maybe lose to Oregon, but then win out? And find themselves in a situation where they're maybe, you know, 5-5 with the last two games. And you have to win out, put yourself in a 7-win team. That could be great. Minnesota's playing good football right now. I think they beat Nebraska, but Wisconsin's playing good, or Minnesota's playing good football. And to have Wisconsin and Minnesota at the end of the year like that, that'd be a big game. But the way it sits for Oregon right now, Oregon should win this game against Wisconsin, and they should win it fairly easily, at least by 2 touchdowns. If you're talking about Wisconsin playing really good defense, maybe it's a weather game, maybe they escape with it being only a touchdown or a 10-point win, something like that, that's fine as well, because again, elements can play into that. But at the moment, I would assume, and again, I'm not a betting guy, I thought it was funny, I went and looked back at the betting line for the Maryland game. It was a 57.5 overall over-under. And it was at 57 points. Man, Vegas knows what the hell they're doing, dude. And then it was at 24 points, I guess, for the Ducks, and they only got by 21 points. So, looks like right now Oregon opens up at a 2-touchdown favorite, 14 points. 52.5 is the over-under. So, again, who's going to win this game and how are they going to win this game? To me, Oregon's defense is good enough to be able to play with anybody in the country. And Wisconsin is not, to me, proven to be a good enough offensive team against good defensive teams. Doesn't mean Wisconsin can't score points. Oh, they can. But it feels like to me that when they are up against a team that's decent for the most part, they're going to struggle with it a little bit. And again, I don't know exactly what their they have a pretty balanced offense between Locke and Walker as running back. Braden Locke is quarterback. I've enjoyed watching Wisconsin this year. Don't get me wrong. But it just feels like Oregon right now is on one of those runs where they can't let a team like Wisconsin get in the way of it. And in years past, this is where Oregon would have lost this game. This is the ASU game. A couple, 3 years ago where they were in the running of it. This is whatever, Stanford, during Chip Kelly era, whatever game you want to put into play where they lose the game they shouldn't lose. This would be it. And, you know, trap games can look a variety of different ways. Maybe this is a trap game because you have a bye week the next week. You know, call it what you want. But I feel like Oregon right now is a team that is mentally very strong. They have a clear path in front of them. I don't feel like they're going to let anything get in the way of that. And I feel like they had a little bit of a slow start maybe against Maryland a little bit. I think you could have a slow start against Wisconsin a little bit too and still find your way into the winner's circle. Wisconsin's a great team with a great fan base. Camp Randall will be rocking, jump around. I would love to be there. But I do think that Oregon will take care of business and put themselves in a position to be in this Big Ten championship. Next week's game against Indiana and Ohio State is going to be the game in the conference. And I think if you look at Ohio State, rematch with Oregon sounds fantastic. If Oregon takes care of business and Indiana does, then it's an Indiana-Oregon matchup. Wow. Wow. And Indiana escaping from Michigan only 20-15 says a lot about that. So Should be an awesome time. Thank you guys so much for watching. Again, I do a live stream Tuesday nights, 5:30 to 7:30. If you guys want to join in and chat, here to chat. I talk about top 25 college football. I talk about Big Ten football. And I talk about anything else that's happening in the world of sports. All right, y'all. Thank you guys for watching Sports Chat 503. We'll see you guys next time. As always, go Ducks.